Welcome, welcome once again to the Radical Imagination. I'm your host, Jim Vrettos. I'm a sociologist who's taught at John Jay College of Criminal Justice and Yeshiva University here in New York City. And one of the general themes we've had in this show is to bring voices, transformative voices from all generations to our world and to try to understand how people are making sense out of that world and trying to change it intellectually, politically, morally, spiritually, artistically. And today I'm really, really pleased to have a wonderfully gifted young writer. Her name is Sabrina Geffner. Sabrina is a gifted young writer, film director, and actress based in New York City. Her most recent short, Dead Weight, is set to be released to festivals worldwide in September. She shares a love and passion for filmmaking with her father, the critically acclaimed ventriloquist Jonathan Geffner. And she's appeared as second assistant director and as Zoe in numerous episodes of Jonathan's multi-award-winning web series Trillo and Suede, which is about a New York City ventriloquist and dummy detective, perhaps somewhat defective as well, but detective duo. Sabrina is finishing her Master's of Fine Arts in Film Directing at the School of Visual Arts in Manhattan. And I'm so really very well, very pleased to have her here as a representative of, is it Generation Z, right? Okay, we've got to keep the generations clear in my head. Of course, I'm a baby boomer, so that's about, but all right. Listen, you have grown up in a world, wow. What are we on? 2-3 years of this pandemic shutdown.
All right.
We've had 4 years of a narcissistic neo-fascist. The doomsday clock is moving closer and closer to nuclear holocaust. We had a show last week with Bill McKibben talking about ecological disaster, and you've inherited a world that's profoundly hurt and dysfunctional. And of course, my generation did too as well. But we had a little time to breathe and grow and develop in a sense. And you've been thrown into so much so early on. Tell us a little about your background and how you came to be involved in some of the work you're involved in as a filmmaker. And we'll turn to some of that work and talk about it in just a few minutes.
Yeah, so it's true. There's a lot going on in the world right now. And I feel in particular with everything that's going on, filmmaking has been a really great medium to kind of show what a lot of people are experiencing and feeling. And I guess some of my background, I like took a class in high school, like a lot of people, for filmmaking, and I realized I had a knack for it and I was really into it. So I like attended other like programs throughout high school. I attended a program to learn about like old filmmaking with 16 millimeter film. And then I took like a program at New York Film Academy, like a high school program. And I just slowly started working and interned at a studio. Got hired there, and then I really wanted to go and, you know, to undergrad and just go to SVA for filmmaking. And right now I'm going into my junior year for film directing at SVA in Manhattan. So that's been a lot of my background. And I learned a lot also from working with my dad, who has a similar passion for filmmaking. And it was just kind of a coincidence that we both were really into that. So it was nice.
No, wait. No, okay. First of all, where did you go to high school?
I went to high school at the Village School. It's a very small school in Great Neck, New York. It's, very few people. It's not exactly like a charter school, but a little bit. So it was a very small school, but that definitely helped me have a lot of time to be able to like explore other things like filmmaking and trying other artistic like endeavors and things like that. Uh-huh. So
you use the word coincidence that you and your father. But is it so much a coincidence? I mean, what are some of the family forces behind your decision? What are some of your muses? What are some of the emotional if you will, environmental, emotional, psychological issues that you were trying to come to grips with as you pursued this career?
Yeah, I think that coincidence is not the best word. I think that the reason I said coincidence is because I grew up a lot with filmmaking, you know, just films in general. I grew up with my dad watching old films, especially film noirs and a lot of classics like The Wizard of Oz. And just, I definitely grew up with that. And because I grew up in such a like artistic household, my sister being a singer and also into old movies. I think that it was less of a coincidence and more environmentally just kind of growing in a very accepting household that like really allowed me to pursue artistic things. And I think I've just been in a very lucky environment to be allowed for that.
So interesting. Okay. So a lot of, as you say, old movies, film noir movies. What did you bring from those experiences to your own work? And maybe you can also talk about, excuse me, your most recent short, Dead Weight. How has that been influenced by your family experiences here?
Yeah, Dead Weight, this has been like the biggest short film that I've directed and written yet. And I really owe a lot of that to my dad and, you know, being inspired by like, you know, watching things from your childhood definitely inspire the work that you do later on. And I think old movies in particular, there's something really special about it. I think one thing I also really love about old movies is how things are very slow. And I think that a lot of newer movies seem to have like this quick pace, like everything needs to be done very quickly, cut very quickly. I think that old movies really inspired me to make Dead Weight, because Dead Weight in particular is a film that's very slow. There's a lot of silences. There's a lot of, it's kind of a slice of life seeing into the characters' lives and their relationships with each other and the strained relationships with each other. Dead Weight is kind of a film about a main character, Brand White, and he is feeling very disconnected from the world, a little depressed, and especially with his relationship with his partner, John. But he finds a mannequin at a local antique shop and he brings it home and he begins treating it like his new partner. And basically the film, we're kind of seeing like a slow romance to see if maybe he can reconnect with John again, or if he's going to be stuck working and, you know, pretending to be in a relationship with the mannequin. So that's kind
of... Wait a minute. Slow down here. Okay. So they're coming back with the mannequin. And what do you say? So the mannequin is an attempt to resurrect the romance, or explain that part.
Yeah. So what I imagined the mannequin to be was sort of kind of going back to the theme of the story, which is sort of the fear of intimacy and kind of the human desire to want to be loved, but also maybe too scared of potential hurt or heartache. And I see the mannequin as sort of an easy way out, since a lot of us always want an easy way out to feel loved but not be hurt. And the mannequin's sort of a good way to not have to deal with those, you know, negative consequences of love. I'm very excited to have it released in early September to festivals worldwide. And let's take a look at that.
Hey, I let them out early. Nobody wanted to practice Frosty the Snowman again. Hell, I didn't want to hear it. Where the hell did you get that?
I went to town.
The character that, you know, the partner who's bringing back the mannequin to the apartment, the clip we've seen that we'll be showing is How would you describe his reaction? Because his face is very disappointed, right? I mean, he can't make what are you trying to portray there in terms of that character's reaction to what his partner is bringing back to the
apartment? Yeah. So the way that I envisioned it and wrote it is I see John, the partner who witnesses Bran bringing back this mannequin. I think Bran was definitely not thinking about how John would be feeling about an object replacing him. Besides that, it's just ridiculous that someone's bringing back a mannequin to the household. Even like kind of the undertone. I think that he realizes that Bran is pushing John further away. And instead of being happy that he's bringing back something, I guess that's like a little unique or weird, he's seeing it as like Bran is slipping deeper into like his depression and not facing their relationship.
Wow. And so enhancing the disconnectedness. And so, very sad. So the opposite is happening. The hope to create more intimacy is actually bringing us further apart or in the movie. And you see that as a larger statement of what's going on in the country and the world.
I definitely do.
Your generation in particular.
Absolutely. Yeah. I definitely think particularly with, very, clearly the pandemic and everything like that. I think that people are more disconnected than ever with each other. And that also can stem into relationships and friendships. And I think that I guess I was partially inspired by just the pandemic and the world we're living in right now, where we're having a really hard time being with each other and being real with each other. So this is sort of like a little bit of a weird, surreal way of showing it with a mannequin.
Yeah. Well, it's not so weird. This is a reality for many of your friends and colleagues in your generation, correct?
Yeah, definitely.
So the dead weight is obviously the mannequin, right? That's being brought in that we're all thinking is going to partly save us. So is it an attempt to make a judgment about the technology, the lack of the structure to bring us together? Now, partly due obviously to the pandemic, but also partly due to the cold and militaristic and fear-based world that we continue to create and perpetuate.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that. I think that, the world is, even besides the pandemic, I think that what you were saying about technology, I have a huge like fear of technology really making people more disconnected. I love technology in a lot of ways. I like that I can connect with people in some ways that I wouldn't be able to, and meet other people and look up things very easily. But I also think that it's really disconnecting ourselves with other people. And I do think that kind of relates to the idea of dead weight. We're looking for replacements for things that we can't have when we're actually together.
Yeah. Well, as you know, the rates of depression, loneliness, alcoholism, the turning to pornographic sites, all substitutes. And on the other hand, also people feeling such a relief, in a sense, not having to go or not really wanting to go back to work and to the office, quote unquote. So what does that tell you about the larger society? The pandemic is, in a sense, is a symptom. It's not the answer. It's not even the prime cause of why people are so lonely. Perhaps we were and disconnected. Perhaps we were long before that and have been for many, many decades.
Yeah, I do think that the pandemic was only just a way that kind of spiraled us faster into wanting to be kind of disconnected and not have to deal with, people in person. But I think it's true that it's just human nature that we don't want to have to deal with each other, and we don't want to have to deal with ourselves if we want to go even deeper than that. I think that it's just human nature that we don't want to don't want to have to deal with people and don't want to, I guess, go to the office or don't want to have to see people in person and have the excuse that you're quarantining or you're working at home. I think it's just the perfect way out.
Yeah, yeah. I push back a little as a sociologist to human nature. I mean, we learn these things through our culture. And I hear what you're saying, but it also takes such a wide, there's such wide consequences to all this, denying our, history of racial injustice, not wanting to deal with economic inequalities at a deep, profound level. We have really the lack of will, moral, intellectual, and artistic, and certainly that's why I'm so interested in your work and your attempts to help us in a way reconcile these contradictions and conflicts. Do you want to tell us a little about that without giving everything away of your answer here or a little more about your dead weight? What happens? Or you want to give it all away right now?
A little bit.
We can't be left with.
Yeah, well.
A little.
I will say that there is a little bit of hope at the end.
Okay.
There's a little bit of happiness. Don't want to give everything away, but it's kind of, we're seeing the journey of Bran White and, how he might be starting to face his fears of intimacy and, connectivity with his partner, but
okay. Yeah. Now, you've also been working on a number of other shorts, and so Hunt Cece, tell us. We're going to play a brief excerpt from that. Tell us a little about that.
Yeah. So, Don't Tell Aunt Cece. It's kind of a film about the main character's name is Elena. She visits her estranged rich Aunt Cece for money, but spills coffee over her expensive new rug, and the magical portrait of Aunt Cece comes to life. It threatens to tell the real Aunt Cece what happens, and Elena must find a way to stop her before it's too late. So that is kind of the overall story behind it. This is a little more of a sillier, less, I guess, deeper film, but I do feel like I was inspired to make this story because I've been noticing, the generational gaps and especially older generations not really understanding kind of the psychological burdens as well as like the financial struggle of younger generations. And I really am a huge fan of making inanimate objects feel alive, whether in this case it was like actual physical and the painting of herself comes to life, but just like in Dead Weight, I just like the idea of thinking that the mannequin's alive. I like a lot of inanimate objects becoming like surreal. Don't Tell on Cece was a film that I written and directed last semester. And I'm very excited that it just released on my website at sabrinazgeffner.com. Let's take a look at Don't Tell on Cece.
Fuck! What are you doing? It's ruined.
Okay, shut up.
It's ruined.
This is why I don't go to our little family gatherings anymore.
You should tell her, or I will.
Hey, wait!
Elena? Do you want Earl Grey or Jasmine?
Earl Grey! Thanks!
I'm gonna give you Jasmine. It's much healthier for you.
Becoming alive. So the idea is to feel more, to feel alive. And you're doing it, as you just said, in your desire to make inanimate objects alive. Could you just pursue that a little more? How is that perhaps also related to maybe some personal family interactions. Is that from your own background?
Yeah, I've definitely been very inspired by my father, who is a ventriloquist. And I think, like, subconsciously growing up in a household where my dad for a living makes puppets come alive and, you know, makes, you know, performances with objects that aren't real, but making them feel real. I think that I in turn sort of became inclined to making stories with things that aren't normally alive, to either feel alive or be alive in some way. And I like how you put it before, which was like, you know, wanting to make things feel alive, because a lot of the ways that we, in which we deal with things, we tend to be disconnected from things. And I think the most extreme case is to make things that aren't alive at all be very animate and alive.
Yeah. And isn't that one of the major goals, objectives, or perhaps it should be, of art and creativity? My mother was an artist. My grandfather was an artist. So I grew up in that. My mother also played the piano. And so I grew up in that environment as well. And, you know, it was a great source of peace and harmony with watching my mother paint and then my grandfather, and having music around the house so much. And it inspired me to just beg my mother to have piano lessons. I didn't need to be told and so on. So I think that's an openness, like you were talking about your high school education there, creating these structural environments, family, schools, political, economic structures that open us up to each other, to each other's past experiences, the traumas we've had. I mean, some term to therapy, and I think that's a very valid, if you've got a good therapist, it's a very interesting process to go through. But the learning of oneself through creativity, through the filmmaking processes you're doing, is also a process of liberation. And if other people see it and feel the same way, there's the connectedness that you're trying to have. So is there more family stuff in CC? I'm sorry, I said Hunt CC. I meant Aunt CC. So is this a real live aunt of yours, or just a fictional sort of one you've made up, or do you not want to?
Yeah, is Aunt CC
still alive, or?
So Aunt CC, not particularly about anyone in particular. Anyone, I will say it's sort of like a collection of either people I've met or maybe a couple people in my family, won't say who, but just collections of personality traits kind of exaggerated into one person. I definitely just was inspired by that. And I think that a lot of us all experience, you know, someone in our family, just someone in our lives that just doesn't understand you and is just does not understand the burdens that you're facing, and just see you as kind of ripping them off or not being there for them. And I think that it's true. I think you put it really well. I really enjoy making films, as cheesy as it is, as a way to, you know, find commonality between people. And a lot of times there's no way to know about someone's personal life or how they're feeling unless you know them very closely. And I think that a film is the best way to show someone who, you know, is fictional, so you can see into someone's life more than I think any other medium. I think film is the best way to show that visually.
Yeah, I understand. It's a process of healing and transformation. So going back to some of the older movies that you watched, do you think they were more sensitive, more nuanced to the human condition, to relationships? And if you can give us a couple of examples of maybe movies you've watched that have really inspired you that, you know, are examples of what we're talking about here.
Yeah, I am very drawn to a lot of movies that kind of get a little bit into that feeling of trying to be connected with others or like loneliness. I mean, there's obviously very fun movies like The Wizard of Oz I grew up watching, but I also watched, you know, other like film noirs. I watched Casablanca.
Casablanca, of course.
Yeah.
Right.
Laura, Now it's on the tip of my tongue, but there's a few other movies. But I do think that in some ways, a lot of older movies do convey sort of more sensitivity for that. But I also think there's quite a few like modern movies that I've also learned to love and are very sensitive to that. I think that it's a couple movies I really like in particular. Like I love Amelie, very classic movie. I think it only came out like 10 years ago. It's such a sensitive movie. And even though it's in some ways very lighthearted, it does also, I was very inspired by that movie to make Deadweight, not just for the style of everything being very warm and kind of eccentric, but also it kind of deals with some deeper themes of also being very lonely, but wanting to be loved. So like the whole story is her trying to, you know, see that guy that she's really into at the very end. And
What's the name of the movie again?
It's Amelie. Amelie is a French movie about this woman who is desperately shy and tries to fix other people's lives by helping them in any way they can with their love lives or their world.
Helping others, yes.
But
how about herself? Yeah.
She neglects her own wants and needs, which is this guy that she really likes. And she slowly is trying to find ways to talk to him, but she can't find a way to do so. So it's very, I think it's very sensitive in that way. Like It definitely explores that. I also like also a modern movie, Requiem for a Dream. It's this movie was an inspiration for my other film, Alone in the Void. And because it's like an interconnected story about people who are all dealing with addiction, but besides addiction, they're all dealing with loneliness and how all of them are dealing with similar problems in their lives, but they all don't know how to tell each other that. So we're kind of seeing their lives throughout. It's a very like as beautiful movie. It's very hard. Like I can only watch it twice and I feel like I need to take a break from seeing it again because it's so real to real life.
And you're talking about drug addiction?
So yes, this movie is particularly about drug addiction, but it's kind of, I would say like it's not really just about drug addiction. It's mainly about people, you know, feeling alone for their issues and not knowing how to tell each other, not knowing how to get help. And I think, you know, just because it's about a drug addiction, you know, you don't have to, you know, have a drug addiction, I feel, to really relate to those feelings of being alone and not knowing how to tell other people that.
No, what you're really attempting to focus on are some very, very classic issues. I mean, I'm just thinking as you're talking, one of the all-time classic works in sociology, written back in the 50s and or 60s, David Riesman, The Lonely Crowd. And that hits exactly, seems like what you're also grappling with. You're calling it the Alone in the Void. Tell us a little about that work.
Yeah, Alone in the Void, basically it's a interconnected story. The main character, James, he's in a household that is really pushing him to try to pursue his craft, which is being a claymation artist, but he's having this mental blockage that's stopping him from continuing his craft. And throughout the story, we find out that other people in the story also are dealing with feelings of loneliness in different ways. And he feels so alone in his own world and not understanding that he is dealing with depression as well as loneliness and other things. And it's a very surreal story where he and the other characters seem to meet each other in this void. And they will slowly uncover what that void actually is and what this clay entity that visits all of them actually represents.
So let's take a look at Alone in the Void. This is a work that goes back in a sense to an old sociological classic I read back in the 60s, The Lonely Crowd. So here is Alone in the Void.
So you were saying... You were saying that you struggled to complete work.
Busy working? Are you still doing claymation? Getting any freelance work online?
I have. I mean, not recently.
And why not?
To for our viewers out there, tell us. What keeps you motivated? Because I am tired of all the bullshit people keep complaining about.
James. Do you feel there's something in your way?
I'm going to throw this out to you from left field here, but well, anyway, what would you say about the connection to the economic system of capitalism and the loneliness, the void that you're talking about, that separates us, that has a stake in a sense of keeping each other at each other's throats as we compete for the scarce resources of the system? I mean, how much does that play? The economics of, you talked about how the older generation, the older people don't understand the economic struggles, in particular the young people. I mean, at least in my day, you know, I was able to get more than two or three Volkswagen Bugs, Beetles, for $200-$300, and it lasted, you know, for 200,000 miles. You know, I could went over to Europe and hitchhiked, including airfare, for about, you know, for half a year for $600. And people put me up. Literally, I would meet people and youth hostels and Shakespeare and Company bookstore. The bastard great-great-grandson of Walt Whitman had a bookstore there, and he just simply said, you need a place to stay, and four or five other people, and we took care of the bookstore and so on. I mean, this is the sort of communal and connection and community that, in a way, the economic system is not fostering, and let alone thinking beyond our borders. This is one world here. This is suffering that's occurring in so many other parts of the world that most Americans are totally oblivious, not necessarily out of their own fault, just it's not in the papers. People aren't reading that. So we're constantly being bombarded by very, very specific self-interest. And it's understandable that people are trying to survive and so on. Okay, that was a long statement there. I didn't mean it to, but I'm interested in your thoughts about the larger macro economic political forces and how it impacts these wonderful micro stories that you're trying to give us.
Yeah, I mean, I can't say
your own personal struggles, in your own economic struggles. I mean, I know you've had a move. You've tried to find a place to stay, correct?
Yeah.
We won't even get to the rent, right? I mean,
yeah.
Forget about it. I mean, it's ludicrous. Okay.
It's crazy. It's I can't say I'm an expert when it comes to economics, or I can't really speak on other people's experiences, especially because I'm in a first world country. So in a lot of ways, I'm lucky. But if you're talking about earlier with how capitalism is sort of also making people feel alone, I can definitely, you know, understand the struggles with that. I mean, capitalism is, you know, the whole concept of it is that you're, you know, you're in for yourself and you're fighting against other people. And I think that, you know, I guess sort of a way, I guess, back to the stories I'm trying to tell, I think that, you know, in a lot of ways, it's just kind of making people more disconnected. I think that there's just the way that our world is structured, and at least in this country, we're taught that it's better to, you know, be there for yourself and not try to help others as much as you can. And I can't really talk much about economic challenges to other people, but it is crazy right now, even just talking about just how much everything is. It shouldn't be this expensive to live in a city just to get your education. It should be expensive to go to school to get education. And I'm so aware that I'm much more lucky than other people, but even myself, it should not be so expensive just to live and exist. So yeah, I think that's just, it's hard for a lot of people.
And you're a romantic. You're a romantic too. And as you were talking, let's go back to Rick. Let's go back to Casablanca. Rick, here's a disconnected individual, if there ever was one. Right? And he's got his bar there, Rick's place, and his past love that he's trying to forget. It's, what does he say? He doesn't identify with the crazy world around him, the political, military situations and so on. And yet, in the midst of this disconnectedness, what happens? What brings him back to this sense of community, if you will, of connection?
I mean, I think the main thing that brings him back is love. And
that was good. Perfect. You know, it's absolutely.
Simply, love. It's something that you can't push away. I think no matter how disconnected you are, if you push it away now, just like with the story, he, you know, his old flame comes back and he can't help but have feelings again, something that he's just pushed away for so long. And I think that that's sort of the frame for a lot of stories, because I think a lot of human beings are that way too.
Couldn't agree with you more. tell us your connection to Casa Noir, which you were part of, again, one of your father's short documentary that's a takeoff on Casablanca. So what was your role in that, and what do you make of that? And that connection to the old Casablanca and the film noir movies that you've been watching.
It's so Casa Noir is like a kind of parody, but also like a romantic comedy inspired by Casablanca and the story behind that, but with the like a ventriloquistic twist. And my dad is the actor, and he wrote and starred in this film. And I was very lucky to have been the first assistant director. It was really fun to work on this, because very few people can say they worked with their dad on a film where he was a ventriloquist detective who kind of played like the Rick character. It was so fun, because like at the time I was living with him when he was writing it, and it was fun to hear like the different versions of it slowly being put together, and you know, just growing up with him, knowing his other work. It was really fun to see a lot of the inspirations for it, and I had such a good time assistant directing with a really great director. It was really like, it was a challenging shoot. That we even did like the classic Casablanca airplane scene,
right,
and being at the airport when finally I saw the airplane there, and I saw Katerina, who plays the femme fatale, like dressed up in the full like vintage 1940s outfit, and like my dad in the trench coat. It was very like surreal, like, oh my God, we're actually doing this. It was very, very cool. It looked just like, you know, Casablanca.
And you were a little, I mean, right? I mean, Sabrina, you've been doing this since you were a little kid. He's playing with the puppets and you're growing up and listening to this, right? Since you were a child.
Yeah.
What a gift. I mean, it must have been so wonderful. I mean, there's, as far as I can tell, we, as you know, we've done a couple of shows with Jonathan, but I don't think there's a puppet that replicates you in any way, but you play, and we're going to play also an excerpt from short excerpt of the season 2 episode where you play Zoe.
Zoe was back. The look on her face told me she was in trouble. The kind of trouble a teenager can get into if she breaks away from her Hasidic family and becomes a cosplayer.
I'm in deep shit.
Let's hear it.
The Brooklyn cosplay convention's in 3 days, and the Princess Malka costume's been stolen.
I wouldn't figure you for a princess character.
No, it's for my friend Malka's costume. I was keeping it for her because her parents are cosplay phobic. The costume, it means everything to her.
Your friend and her costume are both called Malka?
Harmless narcissism,
When in Lira is it stolen?
I've been working part-time for my uncle.
Rabbi Nochem.
Norman. So yeah, I had the costume locked in a closet. Figured I'd pick it up this morning when I made a delivery of Schmutzig Puppet Knishes to Temple Gates of Guilt. But it was gone.
You do please me, Suede. And I'm a hard woman to please.
Not hard for me, Dollface, because I'm always hard.
It's hard to find a man who's always hard.
Holy shit! I didn't know Oi Boys are a thing. I'm gonna close my Tick Schlock account.
We're rolling, guys!
So you're not part of the puppet crew, correct? You don't represent any of the
puppets. I don't. Definitely not.
Definitely not. That's probably, yeah. Okay, whatever. And but you do play Zoe in
yes.
a number of, what, 8 or 9 or 10 episodes. And I told my audience, again, you all need to absolutely see Trillo and Suede and Google that. It's just unbelievable. And you know, look, I've told you, Father, this, he is an unbelievable ventriloquist. I mean, just forget it. Just look at it. Look at him. And, you know, anyway, people should check that out. But you played Zoe. What are the what's this character? Because act in a much different way than you're acting or coming across now.
Oh,
what's
yeah.
But Zoe.
Zoe.
Yeah.
Yeah. Zoe is such an interesting character. It's so the inspiration behind it is my dad told me this is sort of an exaggeration of what I was like in high school. And I will agree, I was quite like that in high school, just kind of very, had an attitude. She's very sassy. She
sassy.
Definitely very
sarcastic,
very much like just there to just, I'm always like kind of poking fun at him. And
a little ingenue, maybe.
Maybe. I think
a little, okay. Yeah.
I think her character is, so because the shows like with season 1 and 2, it's very much like a film noir kind of style. He told me that Zoe was very much a character that's like supposed to break all of that and almost be like a wall break, where it's like a character who is like in the wrong show, who just shows up and insults him and points out, you know, the weirdness that a lot of film noir movies and shows, like a lot of the kind of funny elements of it on without meaning to. And she's kind of there to kind of poke fun of it or bring that out and sort of just be like a character that's always floating around in the wrong genre. So I appreciate that kind of humor.
Yeah. And so many of the puppets are also just hilarious. And what's her name? Levinsky and Rabbi, and so on. Levinsky. So tell us a little about the Jewish connection here. Why are so many of these puppets and so many of the skits in a way, they're Jewish oriented. What is that about? Help us understand. Help the audience understand what's going on there.
Yeah, it's definitely unique. No film noir movies, or not the ones I've seen, have any kind of Jewish elements. This is really my dad's own influence in the show and also in Casa Noir, the movie. It's because, so my dad and I were both like ethnically Jewish. We don't exactly celebrate any of like the Jewish traditions, but a lot of our humor and our culture and our family members, a lot of it's Jewish and a lot of Jewish humor. And I think that a lot of his characters in the show especially represent a lot of people in our family. And
really?
Yeah, definitely a lot of people in our family. Okay. Very interesting people. Even just our humor, just the kind of Jewish jokes that we, you know, kind of pass to each other, he really incorporated into the show. So it's kind of interesting. And I really like that he added a lot more like Jewish humor than just trying to keep it only and strictly humor that might be in like a, I guess, film noir style.
And again, It's a way of connecting family members who are some are very difficult to take, maybe alone. but no, you know what I'm saying? We all have it. I consider myself ethnically Jewish as well. But in any case, yeah, I mean, you are making this connection to a very rich tradition and trying to join disparate family members through jokes. I'm sure that's been, you know, I know it's done in Woody Allen's work or Mel Brooks and certainly the Marx Brothers, who I know your father admires enormously, particularly Harpo Marx. Are you a musician as well? Do you play?
Definitely not a musician. I play a little guitar. I definitely grew up musically, and my dad tried getting me into instruments, but I definitely am more inclined for film. But maybe one day I'll be more into music. I really appreciate the music in my family, though. I really I've gotten very a lot of appreciation for music and films. I have a lot of appreciation for my dad, who plays the piano, and my sister's a great singer. It's definitely it's in my life, and I think it did inspire me to be even more into film, because music is so important in films. And sometimes I'll just listen for fun, soundtracks for my favorite movies, and it's really great. I really appreciate people who can compose too.
Right. And upload your mind. We haven't talked about that. Tell us a little about that work of yours.
Yeah. So Upload Your Mind, I wouldn't call it a music video since I didn't write the music myself. This music came from Grimes. She's a famous synth pop singer. And she wrote this song she has a lot of work that's kind of inspired by technology or AIs taking over. And I think it was late at night about last summer, I heard the song and I heard certain verses that gave me this idea for the story. And the story being, this girl got herself into a car crash, and she, a hologram woman she finds in also a void of some sorts, offers up the chance to live forever when she finds herself in this car crash. The only problem is that if she lives forever, it means that her mind will live forever into this thumb drive. And I love Black Mirror, and I love Blade Runner, and I have so many sci-fi stories that kind of give us the kind of negatives of technology and how it can really affect our lives maybe in the future. And I think it's just late at night, I had this kind of scary, terrifying thought. So I filmed this all just in my dad's basement with just my DSLR camera, and I filmed it in one night and and a little bit in the day, and I just edited it all in a day. It was just a project I really just was very inspired by, and I wanted to see how to make it. So I starred in it. I guess wrote the story, and I filmed it myself and edited it myself. So it was all just a small project I wanted to do in my dad's basement, but it was really fun. I was so happy to see that it worked, and it really worked with the music, I feel.
You know, technology is a double-edged sword. Are we going to exist as figments of thumb drives? Are we going to Are we going to be extinct? Are we going to all become so robotic? Are we going to have the sort of transformative love communal experiences that, you know, the romantic, the great creative artists through the ages have tried to instill our hope for, whether it's a Beethoven or Chopin. I'm thinking again of great liberators of music in the sense of Stravinsky or so on. And so again, you're going back to that theme, the inanimate objects here and making them alive. And wow, the struggle we're in to stay alive, and in what form are we going to be alive? And your work seems to also leave us hopeful. And I think that is very hopeful. I think that's very important. Don't you? I mean, in terms of artistic creative creations, isn't it important? What impact do you, let me put it this way, what impact would you want to have on the audience, on your audience?
Yeah.
What do you want them to get from your work, to feel from your work?
I think you put it really well, and I appreciate that. I really want to make stories that do, you know, highlight experiences that a lot of us feel. And in particular, I, as you said, I love the themes of people being disconnected or people feeling more alone. And I think that, you know, with different kind of surreal elements and making, you know, objects be alive when they aren't, it's just my way of showing that and hoping that maybe other people can relate. And I also, as you said, I really hope that there is some, you know, hope in the work that I make. I'd like to continue making stuff like that. I think that'd be like the goal.
And I really also, I think it's so important to have these intergenerational connections, because too often my generation is off where I don't know what. But I know we had Bill McKibben on the show last week, and he's talked about a new part of his environmental movement, the third act that he has now organized and helped develop. It's for people over 60 now joining in a movement. It's sort of, again, the third act of life, where many in my generation participated in some of the challenges that were going on then, and many dropped out in a variety of ways during the second act, but now this is the third act. And what we also have to do, what I feel very strongly, and I've tried to do in the show too, is make not only a lot of other connections, but, and I appreciate so much you being here, the intergenerational connections that we need to have. As I listen to you, I mean, I'm thinking of the Grateful Dead that came to Columbia University when, okay, you know, the students were taking over the buildings. And I happened to be one of those in 1968. And Abby Hoffman and the Panthers and Mark Rudd, who's been on the show. I mean, in other words, the connections are there, the same issues. What was happening with these impersonal, the bureaucratized, institutions that really didn't give a damn about. You think elders don't care about young people today? It's not any different. All right? If you did your if you followed a certain course, no pun intended, you would be rewarded to be part of a system that was creating and perpetuated enormous dysfunction, including the Vietnam War. Anyway, what I'm trying to get at here, my long-winded way, is I admire and respect you so very much, and your work at such a very early age holds, you've already created a body of work that I think is very, very important. And I hope you'll get a wide viewership on this, because I look forward very, very much, more than you know, to see how all of this progresses as the years go by. And as you grow and develop and carry on some of the traditions that you're already a part of.
I really appreciate it. This has been so nice. This is such a great, you know, a great talk. I really, really enjoyed talking about all this. Thank you.
Well, thank you. And we just have a minute or two left. Is there ways of our audience connecting with you or in that digital world out there, whatever it is.
Yes.
technology that we need to have too. Listen, there's some good stuff to this technology. If you go ahead. Yes.
Well, there's definitely great ways. Seriously. One way you can see any of the work that is released, it will be on my website, SabrinaZGeffner.com. So just my first name and then middle initial and then last name. That's where you'll see any of the films that will come out. I really appreciate, you know, the time that I've been here. Also one other way, Instagram. Yes. Sometimes I release like promos or just like a new poster I just released for Dead Weight. On my Instagram is frames per sab. So like frames per and then S-A-B.
Okay. And now this film festival, it's going to be in September. Is that correct?
Yes. So yes, I'm releasing it to a lot of festivals worldwide. Unfortunately, I can't release it yet just to the public in September. I do have to wait at least a few months for festivals to see if they get into festivals. A lot of them have rules about showing it to other people, but I will announce once it's finally I can show it to people and show all the hard work that I and a lot of people are involved in this film.
Great. This has been a joy. And, I'm being sort of silly here, but here's looking at you, kid. And Humphrey Bogart was one of my, I love anything and everything that he was in. And so we're romantics from different generations here, but we're carrying on the struggle and keep strong, keep well. And thank you so very, very much for being part of our show today. Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Okay. All the best. And thank you so very, very much, all of you, for watching us today on The Radical Imagination. We'll see you again next week on The Radical Imagination.